Centuries had passed, and the dream of a coming Messiah was no more than just that, a dream. Oh yes, there was that little commotion in the little town of Bethlehem 25 or 30 years ago. A baby was born to a young couple from the village of Nazareth. It was said that the mother had been visited by an angel and told that the baby was the Son of God. Well, at the time there was great excitement, but it soon died down as time went by. Then came John the Baptist. He lived in the desert, preaching and proclaiming that the Messiah had come, and that we should repent and prepare to meet the Lamb of God. Hundreds would go out to hear John, some to mock and scoff, but most because they believed or wanted to believe. One day, when John was in full flow, he paused and looked up. There was a young man coming toward him, and he proclaimed, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." Beginning of the most wonderful few years we would ever remember. By the way, the young man John the Baptist baptized that day was called Jesus of Nazareth. That's right, the one the angel announced 30 years before. Everywhere throughout the region of Palestine, people were talking about the young teacher who was traveling around the towns and villages. Some said he was a prophet, others said a teacher, and there were those who believed he was who he said he was, the Son of God. Many of these had no reason to doubt him because they had witnessed the miracles that he had performed. Some had even seen him raise the dead back to life. At this time, in Judea's troubled history, Rome was the supreme authority, and word was beginning to filter through about the young teacher, as they called him. The religious world was taking note as well, as Jesus continued to be thronged by multitudes everywhere he went. Some days, they would travel for miles and sit and listen for hours as Jesus taught them concerning the kingdom. One day, just as Jesus had finished talking with the crowd who had come to hear him, he was confronted by a Roman soldier. Now, this was no ordinary soldier. This was one of Rome's elite and most respected, a centurion. His name was Marcus, and he had served his country well for many years and through many campaigns. Since coming to Judea, he had acquired a number of servants who served him at his villa. Now, although a high-ranking soldier and a loyal Roman, Marcus was a just and fair man who believed that although a man may be of a different race or color, he was still a man and should be treated as such. One of Marcus's servants had a special place in his heart. His name was Benjamin, and he was very ill with a life-threatening fever. Now, Marcus had tried doctors, but they couldn't do any more. One evening, as he stood outside gazing up at the stars, another of his servants, Nathan, came out to him and fell on his knees before him.
Master, forgive me, but I must speak with you. I know you love Benjamin like he was your own son, but if we don't get help, he is going to die. Master, I was in the town today, and I heard a man called Jesus speaking. Oh, how he spoke with such love and compassion. And then he prayed for sick people, and they were healed. There was a man crippled, and Jesus told him to stand up and be healed. And the man stood up and started running around, and the people were cheering and worshiping.
Why are you telling me these things? I don't believe in this teacher, or whatever you call him. I am a soldier of Rome. Caesar is my God. This Jesus you speak of, he's nothing, nothing but a fraud.
Forgive me, Master. But if you won't go, may I go and see him? I know he can heal Benjamin.
Ha! You really believe that this traveling teacher can help us, don't you?
With all my heart, Master.
It's against all that I believe in. But tomorrow morning, early, I will go seek out this Jesus. And you had better be right, or I will have made a complete fool of myself. By the way, you're coming with me.
Marcus was not convinced that this so-called Messiah or Savior was the answer to Benjamin's need. After all, Jesus was regarded as an anarchist and fanatic by Rome. Yet, on the word of a servant, he was prepared to go and ask for this man's help, at no small risk to himself. There would be a very large crowd with Jesus, and a Roman asking a Jew for help was unheard of.
The gentle healer came into our town today. He touched blind eyes and the darkness left to stay. But more than their blindness, he took their sins away. The gentle healer came into our town today. The gentle healer came into our town today. He spoke one word that was all he had to say. And the one who had died just rose up straight away. The gentle healer came into our town today. Oh, he seems like just an ordinary man, with dirty feet and rough but gentle hands. But the words he says are hard to understand. And yet he seems like just an ordinary man. The gentle healer, he left our town today. I just looked around and found he'd gone away. Some folks from town who followed him, they say that the gentle healer is the truth, the life, the
Early the next morning, Marcus and his servant Nathan went to find Jesus. It wasn't that difficult. All he had to do was follow the crowd. And they led him straight to the young prophet. As Jesus moved to the center of the crowd, chatter and noise died away. When at last he spoke, Marcus was captivated by what he was hearing. More than once, he had to pretend he wasn't interested when he noticed his servant Nathan watching him. Now, if Marcus was captivated by what Jesus said, he was mesmerized by what Jesus did, because he began to pray for and lay his hands on people. Some couldn't walk. Some were blind. Others were ill with fevers and diseases. And then right before his eyes, the blind were receiving their sight. The lame and the crippled were walking and running, and the ones with fevers were cured immediately. Tears welled up in Marcus's eyes. This was not what he had expected, and yet he had witnessed it with his own eyes. His servant was right. This Jesus, he was no ordinary man. And yet Marcus still felt the conflict raging inside him. He was a centurion of Rome, Caesar and Caesar only is God and must be worshipped. But he couldn't deny what he had just seen.
Master, we must hurry and see Jesus.
I don't know about this. What can I say? I am a Roman soldier. They all but looking at me.
Then, Master, don't think of yourself. Think of Benjamin. This may be our last hope.
Sir, I am a Roman, a centurion. I come before you because my best loved servant lies ill at my home.
I will come and heal him.
No, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof. But if you were to say just the word, I believe he will be healed. I am a man of authority. I say to one, go. He will go. To another, come to me. He will come to me. And to my servant, do it. It will be done.
I have not seen such faith in all Israel. Go your way. What you have asked for, it has been done.
Thank you.
On his way home, Marcus's servant came running to meet him, completely healed of his illness.
Master, look, I'm healed. One minute I was in pain, then nothing. I'm completely healed.
I know, Benjamin. I know. And I know who healed you. I think.
That evening, Marcus found himself alone with his thoughts. He thought about Jesus and how he had commended him for his faith. What faith? I have no faith, he thought to himself. It was a last resort. His servant was dying. There was no choice. No matter how much he tried to explain it all away, Marcus knew in his heart that Jesus was unlike anyone he had ever met. His heart was convinced, but his head was telling him he was a Roman officer. He had responsibilities, and his loyalty was to Rome. News of the young prophet had reached the corridors of power in Jerusalem. The Romans at this stage weren't all that interested, but the Sanhedrin were, because everything Jesus taught was a contradiction to everything they practiced. Two members of the Sanhedrin were Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea.
Your wave, it's improving. Have you been practicing?
No. I'm thinking, I'm trying to decide if this is what I really want to be.
I know. Look at us. We've become everything that we said we'd never be.
Look at the people. Is it the Romans they really despise? Or are we the ones they want a Messiah to come and deliver them from?
Speaking of the Messiah, have you heard about Jesus? You know, that carpenter from Nazareth. They say that he's the Messiah. He claims he's the Son of God. They say that he's performed miracles and he talks about his coming kingdom.
He's crazy, and so are his followers.
Maybe, but just suppose the Messiah doesn't come as some king with a mighty army. Just say he comes, well, like Jesus.
Don't be a fool. You're beginning to sound like one of them.
Nicodemus, you have to admit you are curious about him. Go and see him, talk to him, and find out what he's really like.
Are you mad? I would lose my seat in the Senate if I went anywhere near that imposter.
Then go at night, wear a cloak. No one will ever see you.
All right. But if I do, will you stop all this talk about him?
I might. But I have a feeling that once you meet him, you won't be able to. Good night, Nicodemus. Pleasant dreams.
Nightmares, you mean. Good night, Joseph.
Sleep was the last thing on Nicodemus's mind. He had 100 questions to ask Jesus, although he would never admit this to Joseph. He went and fetched his cloak, wrapped it tightly around him, pulled the cowl around his head so that his face wasn't visible, and went to see Jesus. The disciples and Jesus had set up camp just outside the city, and although it was late, Jesus was still awake when Nicodemus arrived.
Jesus, Master, we know that you are a teacher sent from God. No one could do the miraculous things that you have done except that God is with him.
Truly I say unto you, except a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God.
How can a man be born again when he is old? Can he enter into his mother's womb a second time?
I tell you the truth, except a man is born of water and of the Spirit, he can never enter into the kingdom of heaven. Do not be amazed, and I tell you that you must be born again.
How can these things be?
Are you a teacher in Israel and you do not know these things? If I have told you of earthly things and you do not believe, how are you going to understand when I tell you of heavenly things? Nicodemus, God loved the world so much that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will never die, but will have eternal life.
Nicodemus came with questions and was left with many more. Although the questions he had now were not those of a skeptic, but of someone searching for truth. He didn't know it yet, but he had been face to face with the way, the truth, and the life.
Are you avoiding me, Nicodemus? Is that what you learnt from the Master?
I know who you are, and I know what you are.
You mean what I was. I'm different now. Jesus has forgiven me and cleansed me. I know I deserve to be condemned. But Jesus, he said he didn't come to condemn the world, but to save it. He wants to save you too, teacher.
I know, I heard him. But why should I believe that he is anything more than a prophet?
The fact that you have even risked coming here means in your heart you know who he is. But you are the only one who can make the choice.
In the year that followed, all of Nicodemus's predictions and fears were realized. Jesus went around the country preaching and healing people. He even raised the dead. He grew in popularity with the people, and the more popular he became, the more at odds he was with the Pharisees. A confrontation seemed inevitable. A lot of people knew of the plot to kill Jesus if he returned to the city. But Jesus knew why he had been born, and he knew his Father's will must be fulfilled, even though it would cost him so much.
God looked down upon a world of sin and shame, a world that had forsaken him and turned against his name. And though he knew what it would cost to ransom back the ones he'd lost, he sent his son to win them once again. It cost trust him more than all the wealth of glory. To redeem my sin sick soul eternally. He serves throughout the royal courts of heaven, and he found none but his own son, good enough to die for me. So if you feel that you're not worthy of God's only son, and you wonder why he came to die in spite of all you've done, just listen to that still small voice that asks your heart to make a choice and trust in Jesus Christ, God's only Son. It cost him more than all the wealth of glory to redeem my sin sick soul. He serves throughout the royal courts of heaven, and he found none but his own son, good enough to die for me. He serves throughout the royal courts of heaven, but his own son, good enough to die for me.
Weeks later, Jesus did the unthinkable. He entered Jerusalem. The crowd were ecstatic with excitement. They were cheering and crying, "Hosanna! Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." As Jesus entered the city, he was riding on a donkey, and as he passed by, the crowd spread palm branches in his path. Some of them even laid down their cloaks in his path as they worshipped him.
never guess who's in the city.
Slow down, Nathan. Slow down. Who is in the city?
Jesus, the teacher. He's back here in Jerusalem.
He can't be. He must know how dangerous it is for him to be here. Why, right at this moment, the Pharisees are trying to set him up by using one of his own followers. What am I going to do? I must warn him. But then if I do, I'll be in trouble with Pilate. Nathan, what am I going to do? I must think about this. I need somewhere where I can be on my own.
I know just the place. It's a garden just outside the city.
Marcus was so confused. He was, and always had been, a man of unswerving loyalty. There had never been any doubt in his mind that Caesar and Rome were the only things worth living and dying for. He had never once questioned anything he had been ordered to do. And now his mind was a raging storm, and all because of a simple man who claimed to be the Son of God. Logically, there was no choice to be made. He was a Roman. And yet, how could anyone say and do the things that Jesus did and not be divine? Over and over in his mind, Marcus could hear those simple words Jesus spoke to him. Follow me. Now, unknown to Marcus, in another part of the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus was praying with his disciples. He knew the time was near when the purpose for his coming would be fulfilled.
God, can you hear me? I beg you, can you hear me? I'm not the kind of man who prays. How can I follow this Jesus? Can I follow? But can I turn and walk away? Tonight I stand here all alone, somewhere between this man and the only life I've known. I've never felt so all alone. I feel my heart inside me breaking. How long must I endure this pain? And still my spirit goes on.
Brothers, are you sleeping? My friends, are you sleeping? Could you not watch 1 hour in prayer? Father, I am grieving in anguish. I am grieving. This cup is far too great to bear. God, I long to do your will. I know you'll never leave your only son, but still, I've never felt so all alone. Inside me breaking.
I feel my heart inside me breaking.
How long must I endure this pain?
How long must I endure this pain?
And still my spirit goes on aching. Oh God, please hear my prayer. I need to know that you are. Never felt so all alone, so all alone, so all alone,
so all alone.
God, can you hear me? Your servant, can you hear me?
Can you hear?
So all alone.
Oh, yes.
it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. O my Father, if this cup may not pass from me, except I drink it, thy will be done.
Silence was shattered by the shouting of a large crowd coming into the garden. They had come to take Jesus.
Master.
His disciples ran for their lives as Jesus was led away. The one who was always thronged by multitudes, seeking his touch and his help, was all alone, and no one came to help him.
He was brought before the Sanhedrin and me. Oh, and he remembered me and our conversation of almost a year earlier.
If he was the Son of God, then why didn't he call down the angels of heaven to rescue him?
They couldn't even find any evidence against him until somebody remembered a statement that he had made. Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up again.
Caiaphas called him a blasphemer. This was the one crime we were all afraid to commit, because there was only one punishment, and we were afraid to speak in his defense.
They took Jesus away to be beaten. Then they sent him to Pilate, then Herod, then back to Pilate, who finally ended the charade by symbolically washing his hands of the whole affair and handing him over to be crucified. When they finally brought Jesus back to the judgment hall, he was almost unrecognizable. His face was bruised and bleeding, and blood was running down his forehead from a crown plaited with thorns, the they had mockingly pressed into his head. Then in one final act of humiliation, they put a purple robe on him, mocking his claim that he was a king. And all this time, standing in a corner trying to stay well out of the way, Marcus stood. There was nothing he could do. This was way out of his territory. He felt so helpless. From the judgment hall, they took Jesus outside the city to Golgotha. And there they crucified him on a cross.
I should have said something. I could have told Caiaphas that Jesus was the Messiah. I could have told him that he loved them. I could have told him that I believed in him. I could have, but I didn't. I was too afraid to lose my own life. So I let them take his.
We're all guilty, Nicodemus. None of us did anything to help him. But he still loves us. Nicodemus, I know he still loves us.
To tell you about the love of Jesus, where do I ever start? He touched me. He changed me. When he healed my broken heart, when he healed my broken heart. Father, forgive them, he cried.
I'm so, so sorry, Nathan. There was nothing I could do.
I know, Master. It's not your fault.
But Marcus, why? Why would God let this happen to his son? He did no harm. He didn't do anything wrong. Why?
I don't have any answers. All I know is what he said when he was teaching. He said that God's ways are not our ways, and that we must believe on him even though we don't understand.
I do believe, my friend. I do believe.
There are moments on our journey following the Lord, when God illumines every step we take. There are times when circumstances make perfect sense to us, as we try to understand each move he makes. But when the path grows dim and our questions have no answers, turn to him. Bow the knee, trust the heart of your Father when the answer goes beyond what you can see. Bow the knee, lift your eyes toward heaven and believe the one who holds eternity. His plan.
And when you don't understand the purpose of his plan, in the presence of your
Nicodemus and Joseph took the body of Jesus and laid it in a tomb that Joseph had purchased for himself. He felt it was the least he could do to try and make up for not taking a stand. The soldiers rolled a huge boulder across the entrance and sealed it so that no one could get in and take the body. The Romans and the religious leaders had heard how Jesus had prophesied that he would rise again from the dead after 3 days, and they wanted to make sure no one could steal the body and claim that Jesus was alive.
Our Savior's body, their hearts were
days after the crucifixion, Nicodemus and Joseph were talking. They were searching the scriptures for answers to the many unanswered questions they had. But they had no idea what was happening up at the tomb.
He's alive! He's alive!
Hey!
Jesus, the Messiah!
How do you know?
The tomb, it's empty. We saw two angels, and they told us that Jesus had risen, just as he said. And then I saw him, and he spoke with me.
It's been 3 days. I will raise it in 3 days. He's alive, Nicodemus. Jesus is alive.
Yes, Joseph. And you know what that means, don't you?
No, tell me.
You can have your tomb back because Jesus doesn't need it anymore. Come with me. I found some of the disciples. Let's go and tell them.
Master, he's risen. He's alive. I talked to some of his disciples. He's alive.
Are they sure?
Yes, some of the women even spoke to him. Master, Jesus is alive.
Thank you. Oh, thank you. Thank you.